Hi, everybody. It's Nate Grohek. I'm so excited to have our special guest today, Jenika McDavitt of Psychology for Photographers. She's been a photographer for several years, went to Yale University and got her master's degree in psychology, and eventually saw this awesome blend that she got to take her two passions together and start this great blog. I've been a fan ever since I've been a photographer, and I've really been excited to have her on the show. Just as a reminder, today's show is sponsored by Sticky Albums, where we let pro photographers share and create custom mobile apps for each of their customers. We'll go into more examples of how you can use Sticky Albums later in the show. But more importantly, we're going to talk about some of the really important reasons that go into why your clients hire you. So often when we are working with the business of marketing our photography business, we get too focused on how our business is different or differentiates from the competition. Those are great things to talk about, but I want to talk with Jenika about what happens before that. What are some of the motivations that go into why our clients want to hire a professional photographer? Jenika's also written the book. What is the title of the book? Irresistible Website, or Building Your Irresistible Website?
How to Build an Absolutely Irresistible Photography Website. It's kind of long.
I love it. It's just a wonderful book. Jenika is an awesome writer, so we're going to talk about that as well. And leave you today with some really tangible, practical things you can take and start putting into action today. So Jenika, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much.
You're very welcome. So, tell me more about what got you into photography and how you started to see this psychology element playing such a big role.
Well, I was the stereotypical kid with the camera, and I started photoblogging in 2005 when I did a lot of study abroads and started studying composition and wanted to make my photos good. So that's kind of when I started doing photography. But it wasn't until grad school that I started photographing people with intention besides just snapshots. And I started photographing my fellow grad students to practice and to learn more about how to work with people. And I realized I'd been doing all this clinical training about how to make people feel calm and how to understand where people are coming from. And I realized that this was all directly applicable to what I was doing in photography. And the more I dug into the business of it, the more I realized that psychology and things like cognitive biases and decision heuristics all played into what you do in a business. And so I saw this huge potential to be talking about this, and I started a blog in 2011 called Psychology for Photographers. So, story.
I love it. It's so great. And for those of you who have not checked out the blog yet, what I love, I'm such a dork about neuroscience and the what goes into influencing our behavior and our choices. But I'm also really impatient and a little dyslexic. So I love to read, but you've got to explain it to me very simply in ways I can understand. And Jenika is amazing at doing that. So absolutely check it out. I think that as business owners, I got into photography because for similar reasons. I was driven by the art side of it, the creative outlet it was for me. And then after you like throw yourself into this, and you're like, oh wait, I've got to figure out the business side of this too. And that's been by far for me just as important or just as fun of a learning experience. And I think you really help people navigate how do you start pricing is a really tricky thing, because I think you get into so many of us are, I was driven to start charging by friends and family. Mm-hmm. And that's the weirdest group of people to start charging. And there's a lot of weird psychology into how do I decide that I can charge for my art and stuff. But yeah. I think you've offered some good advice along the way. So let's move to, I think what triggered me reaching out to you for this specific interview is I went to 5 photography conferences this spring, and just it's a total whirlwind, amazing to talk to so many of our customers, talk to other photographers who are thinking about sticky albums and trying to navigate this digital a kind of evolution that has really changed the landscape of photography. And we continue to hear this challenge where so many photographers are just stressed out with, all my clients want are the DVD. They just want the digital images for Facebook, and that's all they care about. They don't care about prints anymore. What should I do? And I really empathize with that challenge. And then also talk to some other photographers who have kind of grabbed this challenge by the horns and are running with it. And I wanted to really understand what's going into all of those things. So let's, with that context, Jenica, what are some of the reasons why you think like a photographer's customers, the consumer, what's really motivating them? Why are they, because everybody's a photographer nowadays, right? They've got a DSLR. They probably have a friend who can do photography. Why do they want to hire a pro? What's the motivation? Why do they want to hire a photographer?
Well, there's sort of the obvious group, which is weddings, which I think is sort of a separate conversation, but, or you have like an event where you want to remember it, and so you hire a professional who knows what they're doing. So that's kind of a separate thing. But then there's also the portrait side of it. And I think that there's a lot of reasons for that. One is people see something that their friends have on Facebook and they want to jump on that bandwagon. Sometimes it is a commitment to their home and home decoration. With the explosion of Pinterest and DIY type things, people are finding more and more creative ways to use images and to personalize their homes. So I think that plays into it.
Yeah.
And also just, we trade in images nowadays. I've never met you in person, but I've seen you online, and I probably was introduced to your picture before I was introduced to you. And so the way you present yourself online when you're sharing kind of matters. And so there's a lot of reasons, but I think all of that plays into it.
Yeah, I think you're right. When I was at WPPI, Dane Sanders was talking in his session about the motivation to share, where I think the motivation to share our photography, and he had an interesting caveat that we're also, not only we're sharing with everybody we know, like instantly, but we're also motivated to share, like we want to share for the future, so we can, or share with our future self, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that we have like the album that lasts forever, so we can always come back to it and remember the good old days.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that motivates some people, but what I, in talking with a lot of my customers and other people on the road, I found that this technology has changed the way we share pictures.
Mm-hmm.
And so when we want to share, like let's say rewind 10 years, you got your pictures taken, you got wallet prints of your kids or the wedding or whatever, and then, or you bring your book around and you could share in person the same way, and then you'd put them on the wall. So that was fine. But now that technology has made sharing so easy,
mm-hmm.
and it's become so important, it started to eclipse the need for print. So
mm-hmm.
in our clients' like short-sighted emotional purchase decision, they're like, well, I don't really care about prints anymore, but I saw so-and-so has a blog of their images, and so-and-so made a book on Snapfish or Shutterfly. So all I know is I need the images because I want to be able to share them right away. Can I get them for Facebook? Can you do that right away? Because how long is it going to be? And there's just this like this emotional nervousness, hyperness. They're so excited, right? And so how do photographers tap into that so we can still say, yes, we can help you, but also kind of slow them down a little bit and help them see what they may want? And maybe I'll ask this question first. Sorry to ask like 30 questions at once. I'm kind of excited myself. why do you think people are so bad at understanding and guessing what we want in the future? Let's start there.
So essentially, people, like you said, people are not great at predicting their future emotions. This is like empirically tested. This isn't just me saying it. People are really bad at guessing what's going to be important to them in the future. They're bad at guessing what is going to be emotionally impactful and how intense that emotion is going to be. So for example, stereotype, you know, you work on your career because it's like you think it's going to be really important to you, but then you get to the end of your life and realize, wait, like family was more important. So
mm-hmm.
that applies to many things. And so people, you know, what photographers, I kind of am on this kick where photography is kind of like selling life insurance. Like, you're going to want this later. You know, that's how photographers describe their services. You're going to want these albums later so you can show them to your grandkids, so you can explain who you were and where you came from. And that's really important. The problem is people today are not particularly motivated by what's going to happen in 50 years. They're motivated by what is going to feel good and what's going to happen now. I mean, and that's not a moral judgment. I mean, it's just the way it is.
Yeah, yeah.
So I think, and a big thing, as you alluded to, is this desire to kind of be gain a lot of attention on social media to benefit your business right now. And a lot of those things, those immediate sharing impacts people now much more than the album, than they think the album will in the future.
Right,
that's not
right.
true. But
right.
that's kind of where their headspace is. So.
Yeah, so true. It reminds me of the concept, like, how does it go? Where we're motivated more oftentimes to avoid pain than we are motivated to seek pleasure.
Mm-hmm.
So when we can tap into a client's, like, fear or
mm-hmm.
their current pain of feeling left, like, all my friends have cool pictures hanging on their walls. I want to be part of the cool kids. That's a really powerful motivator because you're removing a current pain. Whereas if you're only focusing on in the future,
mm-hmm.
you're probably really going to want this.
Mm-hmm.
And imagine how good that's going to feel. Yes, we should go there too. But the other way to ask it is imagine 10 years from now and the album you purchased on Shutterfly starts to fall apart or the pictures start to fade. Imagine what that's going to feel like. And I've always been a huge advocate for people to make a Shutterfly book, nothing against a specific company. Let's just say to make one of those, anybody, you can get the very cheap books that
mm-hmm.
are designed for a
yeah.
cheap market. And sometimes that's great for different purposes, but not when you're giving somebody a wedding album or when they're going to make their own wedding album. Let
mm-hmm.
them hold one of those and then give them one of your premium designed, premium printed, like Heirloom quality albums, and let them see the difference up front in person, and they can touch and feel it. That's just the very beginning of starting to show them the value you can deliver over the long term, right?
Yeah, well, and it also, another way to phrase what you just said is people are more motivated in general to solve problems than they are to prevent problems. So if you're selling to the future, you're selling a prevention. Whereas if you're saying, this, you can share this now, you can look at this now, it's better quality now, that's solving a current problem. The problem with that is, let's say I want to put a profile picture up on Facebook. Well, I know that's only going to has a shelf life. You know, it's only going to last me so long.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not going to necessarily be willing to pay a lot of money for an immediate solution that's kind of a short-term solution. And so it is important to still build in the future when you're selling your photography.
Yes.
Because the future aspect is what makes it valuable. I mean, what makes a picture of your children valuable is that your children are going to look different in 5 years and you're going to want to remember this. So you need kind of both. You need the combo of immediate solution to get people to take action and kind of the future aspect so that it makes it as valuable as it is.
Totally. Okay, so I knew I was going to get these awesome, awesome conversation. That's why I've been looking forward to this for a while. So, and I'll stop being completely selfish and change gears a little bit. You talk about, I think the segue I want to use is the first way we start addressing these clients' needs and concerns is through our website.
Mm-hmm.
And in your ebook, Creating an Irresistible Website for Photographers, you talk about, which I think is this great analogy, because so many of us are very small businesses with maybe an employee, probably most of us probably not any employees yet.
Mm-hmm.
But you, to think of your website as an employee. So
mm-hmm.
tell me how you came up with that analogy and how it fits so well.
Well, I think your website is essentially a sales tool. I think photographers in general have gotten to calling their websites a portfolio, which is fine, but I think there's a mistake in that a portfolio, like traditionally, is like it's something that shows what you can do.
Mm-hmm.
Like, this is what I can do, and look at all this great art that I have. Whereas what you need clients is not for them to see what you can do, but see what you can do for them and
mm-hmm.
what you're going to sell to them that's going to make their life better. So getting away from thinking of it as a portfolio and getting towards thinking of it as a sales tool, The great thing about a website is that it's there 24/7. It's there when you can't be. So it's kind of like having a sales force that's out there, and you need it to be interacting with people kind of one-on-one in a sense, that it's not just there for the whole internet to see. You want the client to make them feel like this is just for them, and you're just placing into their hands, and they're completely sucked in and engaged with it. And really, I mean, it's so, anyway, the reason I say it's like an employee is because it's this little salesperson that sits there all the time and engages people for you.
Right.
And if it's not doing its job, which a lot of photographers aren't, you need to fire it.
Yes.
You need to get rid of it. So many photographers spend so much money on their websites. They spend so much emotional energy on their websites, and it doesn't do anything for them. And that would just be completely unacceptable. No photographer that I know would hire an employee, spend, you know, $1,000, $500, any amount of money on it, and if they didn't see any return, they would not keep that employee on. It's
right.
No different with your website.
Right. And it's just so perfect, because the good news is there's so many tools out there. Like, there isn't a Google Analytics for employees, right? It's difficult
right,
to measure the productivity of your employee. It's very ambiguous and tricky. And that's the challenge of any small business when you start to grow, is how do you manage people?
Mm-hmm.
What's awesome is, yes, while I think some of us can be intimidated by the technology, what you should, the really cool thing you can get excited about is that it's very objective. And
mm-hmm.
There's not going to be any mysteries about if it's working or not. You start digging into Google Analytics, and even if you're starting cold, just watch a few YouTube videos about how to install or how to understand different metrics you should be caring about. And like, I think we have a tendency to avoid the things that are a little intimidating, right?
Yeah.
And I've learned that I take kind of I'll check in once a month, like, okay, what are the areas of my business that I feel like I'm avoiding? Because most likely, that's the thing I should work on the most right now. Because it's easy to do the things that we're awesome at. But when you're a company of one, you've got to go to those tricky parts sometimes. And the tools out there for really managing your website well are there. And I think the last analogy you make is that set up like a monthly review or an annual review process with your most important employee, which is your website. Because forgetting about it, here's the other thing, is it's really easy to, if you're not looking in the right places.
Mm-hmm.
Another analogy I've heard people use is if you don't have a storefront, your website's your storefront, right?
Yeah.
And if you had a storefront and people were coming in, like looking around, or like, let's say they come with the door's locked, they can't even get in, i.e. it's flash and they are on an iPhone, guess what? They're gone. That's the first impression. Like you said, your store is open because it's supposed to always be open. This is online, but I can't get in. Okay, never mind. I'm going to the next person.
Yeah.
But you don't feel that. Like, we don't see that unless you're looking in the right place. You don't feel the pain of having customers walk into your store and walk away. I think there's some great techniques you offer and strategies to really get in touch with the foundation, which I think for creatives, this is such a great place to start, because it's going to give you the motivation to get really clear on who you're building your website for.
Mm-hmm.
And that's going to keep you pushing through the rest of the process that gets a little bit tricky. But when you start with that clarity, I think it provides the perfect motivation to finish the project. So in that, you talk about, what are some things we should be putting on our website? If it's not just a portfolio, what else can we be highlighting? And you start to lead us through this process of understanding. Let's start with first, I think, understanding our target client and why it's so important to think of that as one person.
Well, so the thing that you can never forget is that your website only counts if the person sitting in the chair is convinced by it. And so you need to understand where that person is coming from in order to understand whether or not your website is working. So if you, just to go back to the employee analogy for a second, if you have an employee, you measure their, you know, productivity probably first by their sales numbers. Are they selling stuff? And if you go and your salesperson isn't selling anything, then you have to say, okay, well, why? And then you might find out, well, their personality isn't meshing with the person that they're selling to, and they're turning them off and they're running away. It's no different from your website. Your website could be turning people off and you just wouldn't know it till you go and sit down with it. And you alluded to earlier, people are motivated to, you know, solve problems and to avoid pain. Understanding your target client is really about finding what are their pain points, what is causing friction in their life, what is causing problems, because those are the things that they're going to be motivated to solve. And so if you can make your website instead of a portfolio, make it a portfolio of here's how I'm going to make your life easier, here's how I'm going to eliminate that thing that you've been stressing out about, that is going to draw people in, because that's what they want to do, is they want to get rid of pain. They don't want to prevent a problem they might have in 50 years. They want to get rid of a problem that they have right now. That's what caused them to search in the first place.
Yep. Yeah, so true. Okay, so then you go on to talk about linking kind of benefits with the benefits of the results that we as photographers deliver. So what is getting clear, I think when you pull apart all the pieces of the results and the things we're actually delivering, if you're just delivering a CD, like, well, there's more to it. If you're responding to emails, you're helping them with their styling, you're helping them pick a location. There's all of these things that we do that when you pull it apart, we can understand what we're actually delivering our customer, and then framing it from why is that important? Why is that a benefit to our target market? So say more about that.
So, well, let me just clarify real quick, because a lot of business books use this idea, but they don't use the same word. So a result is something that they get. So a result could be a canvas print. A result could be some kind of extra service, like makeup service. So those are the results, like the concrete thing the client actually gets. A benefit is something like, okay, you have a makeup artist. The benefit there is you feel beautiful and calm, like you don't have to worry, am I going to look good? Mm-hmm. The benefit to a canvas is the envy of your neighbors. So there's tangible results, and then there's intangible benefits.
Yep.
So you kind of, and it's like a seesaw, you want both and you want them to be in balance. So a lot of photographers will talk solely about the benefits, like you're going to feel so great and it's going to be so wonderful, but that's just fluff. They don't understand what that actually looks like, so you've got to talk about your results. And on the flip side, some photographers will be like, okay, well, I sell canvases, DVDs, metal prints, you know, cards, and they just list all these products that they sell. But the client doesn't know how to engage with that. They don't know what that looks like, what that is. And so if you kind of match it, it's like a little matching game. If you match it to what they're going to get out of it. So one way that I like to do it personally is relabel something, like as a joke. Like it is a bit of humor, but you could relabel you know, gift prints as a way to make your mother-in-law happy. You know, it's just kind of a, or your canvas as, you know, your latest, like, dinner, make a splash at your dinner party, you know. Just tying those two things together so that they start to see, okay, well, it's this canvas thing. What am I going to use it for? What problems does it solve? You give that to them on a platter by describing the benefits.
That's perfect. Yeah, it's so simple when you like, look at it backwards, but hindsight's 20/20. So that... Well, after reading this, I have to share my aha moment was I spent a lot of time coaching photographers on their portfolios, and that I think the first lesson that I'm optimistic in the majority of our online community is starting to realize that we don't need 100 pictures in our portfolio. So number one, you need maybe 10 awesome pictures, and to include pictures on your blog as you're blogging each client. If it's a client or a project that you don't want to do again, don't include it on your blog. Like, include work and styles of your work that you want to do more of. Mm-hmm. And that's just a kind of a foundational thing that I think we're getting better at. But after reading your book, I layered on top of that is, why are we just showcasing the one of the things we offer? Mm-hmm. Instead of just doing the digital print on the blog, or the digital image, sorry, why not go into our clients' homes and take pictures of everything we've delivered to them? All of the canvas, collage, the canvas collage that we put on their wall, or them going through their book with their girlfriends or something like that. How awesome is that? Would that communicate what you're offering as a photographer and how it's different from what they can get anywhere else?
Yeah, well, this is where photographers, myself included, get hung up is that we think so much about the images and the quality of our images, and we spend all our time like thinking about the images. But that's not, well, it might be, but it's usually not what we really want to be selling. We want to be selling the images on a canvas. We want to be selling the images in an album. And so we end up selling the images by putting them up on our blog and on our websites, and the person gets really excited about that and the idea of sharing it in this way that they're used to,
yep.
which is online.
Yep.
And then we haven't done anything to convince them, hey, like there's a different way to do it, and there's another way that you can impress your friends besides having it on Facebook with 1,000 comments. There's other options. And once they see other people, this is kind of the principle of social proof, they assume what other people are doing is correct, and they see other people doing all this, then that's going to start planting that seed for what they want to do. And since too many photographers wait till the end of the sales process to be like, oh, yeah, no, do you want canvases? Do you want? And then they're like, what? I don't know. I just want. They're confused.
Yeah, right.
Because the currency they're used to trading in is JPEGs.
Right.
That's what comes out of their camera. They understand JPEGs. JPEGs make sense. A 30 by 40 canvas doesn't make sense. So you have to introduce that way, way before you get to the sales session.
Yes. Yep. Yeah, and you do that. And if people are inquiring, like, what? Imagine, so when you have, it makes total sense. You have JPEGs on your blog. People inquire to buy your JPEGs.
Mm-hmm.
That makes sense. You have showcasing client after client of amazing metal prints or books or albums in your blog. You're telling the story of how, what it meant to your client to be able to bring this to her grandmother and show her grandmother the print or the album and flip through it together with family. That's not only is that an emotional story that's going to engage your audience, people are going to inquire to hire you to create one of those, not to take their pictures. That's just a means to an end. They like, I want that book. I want you to make a book for me. And I can already tell I love your images and et cetera, et cetera. That's not as important. And that's what we want our customers to hire us for, right?
Exactly. And I think I want to just hone in on this because it's so great what you just said, which is that, you know, we talk a lot on our blogs about the emotion of the session, and I do this, and we love that, and that's important. But what you were saying was extend that emotion to the emotion surrounding the actual thing you're selling, the actual print, and have them think about that emotion, not just like, oh, pictures, 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 memories, sweetness,
yeah.
but, you know, this moment of handing someone a gift or the moment of...
Yeah.
You know, walking down your stairs in the morning and seeing those images on the wall, talking. We give lip service to it, and I'm guilty of this too. I don't do it enough. We give lip service to this idea, and we'll kind of mention it, but really digging into what it meant for that person. And by the way, our best clients are often clients we've had in the past, like repeat clients.
Mm-hmm.
And if you go into someone's home and talk to them about, you know, what do these images mean to you now, and then you blog about it, that you're convincing that client to come back again. So you're kind of doing... You know, two birds with
yeah.
one stone. So.
Yep. And as so many of our customers become, I think that it would have been difficult to do. So here's a good example. Is it's so easy to focus on the negative of what the technology and Facebook and internet has done to our industry.
Mm-hmm.
But there's amazing positives. We get Facebook is an amazing marketing tool when used right. It can bring us so many referrals. And there's tools like sticky albums that rely on the internet and people being able to share in person, all that great stuff. So it's important for us to remember that while the technology and the internet has changed things, a lot of people are becoming increasingly open. Whereas you may not have been able to go into a client's home and let them and just blog about their experience or take pictures of their walls, I would be surprised if the majority of your clients wouldn't be ecstatic.
Yeah, oh, they're happy about it.
Like, it's like, oh my gosh, I get to be highlighted on this awesome person's blog, and it helps bolster your brand. They look awesome for being showcased,
mm-hmm.
and they just got their walls painted gray, and they've got everything perfect, and the like, putting this awesome artwork on their wall becomes this really big project, or culminating in you documenting it for them and telling this story of this whole thing. And when you can start inserting yourself along that process, that's really powerful.
Yeah.
Okay, so I wanted to wrap up with a couple things. So some in review, a lot of, when I was talking with people on tour or on the road,
mm-hmm.
people really get hung up on, well, when I start offering digital products, whether people want sneak peeks or they just want images for Facebook,
mm-hmm.
I give those away, and then all of a sudden it starts to impact my print sales. And so number one would be to focus more on the early on, as early in the process as possible, meaning on your website, start talking about and telling the story about the other products you deliver, mm-hmm. and helping them understand what else you offer besides helping them share. And a lot of our customers who are just kicking ass are the ones that say, Nate, oh my gosh, this is great. I never do DVDs. I never will. And as a side note, do what works for you, but mm-hmm. use this as a place to start. Everybody in my area is doing DVDs and I don't want to do it. I don't want to go down that road. And so now when I get the phone call several times a day, hey, we like your work on your website. We want to hire you for our wedding. Do you guys sell the DVD of the images? And mm-hmm. now they get to say, well, no, we don't, but we create for you your own custom app that you can share on Facebook. And they're like, oh my God, I can put that on my phone and it mm-hmm. saves and I can share it. They're like, that's what I wanted anyway.
And yeah.
I think that we give our customers like early questions too much weight. We're right again. Like nobody wants prints anymore. It's like, no, it's just the first question they asked. And you can address that objection or that concern really quickly and move on to, we also do this. And we'd love for you to come into the studio and take a look at some of the other work we do, et cetera, and start to build that process to setting the expectations where they should be. So this was just fantastic. Is there anything else you want to add, Jenika, about just the importance of understanding these connections and understanding your target market?
I just wanted to build on something you said real quick about not giving too much weight to what the client says in the first. So quick story. I recently had my makeup done, and I do my own makeup, but like I never go and have it done. I'm not like an expert in makeup. And so she says, well, what color do you want on your lips? And like, what I wanted was just a natural look, but I was like, I don't know. Like, I was like, okay, what color are my lips? Pink. And so she brings out this pink and it's like pink, you know? And I'm like, oh my gosh, what have I done? And then I was like, no, like, you know, I just, you know, the color of my lips. And then she's like, oh, okay. So I think she's the professional. I am the novice. And she like took what I said. She took it literally and gave me something I didn't want. And the only reason that came about is because I didn't have the vocabulary to describe what I really want.
Yes.
So I think this happens with our clients. They see things and they're like, okay, I want to make my mom a book. Okay, I've made books in the past through, you know, my publisher, and I need digital JPEGs to do that. So I'm going to call this photographer and I'm going to say I need JPEGs. Well, you know, that conversation, you know, there's a much better thing that you can give them. But if you just say, oh, they just want the images, that doesn't complete it. So I think getting in saying, okay, what is it you want to do with the images? And just having a friendly conversation, get them excited about talking to you. You can start saying, okay, well, this product might meet your needs better. And guess what? I'd be doing the designing, so you don't have to do it. And like, oh my gosh, it saves me so much time.
Mm-hmm.
So just understanding what, again, it just goes back to understanding what problems your clients are trying to solve.
Yep.
And the only way to do this is sit down with them and ask them to research them, to like not stalk them, but stalk them.
Yeah.
Go hang out where they're hanging out, see what they're talking about, see what they want. And I mean, in the normal business world, not the photography business world, I mean, it's just market research. Like, and nobody would go into any kind of business without studying who they're selling to.
Yeah.
As photographers, I think too often we're like, well, we're making this cool thing. Of course people are going to want to buy it, but we've got to go in and understand who they are, what they're worried about, what they're trying to do, what problems they're trying to solve. And if you can do that, you're going to have a much easier time selling. You're going to be much happier in your business.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So well said. So Jenika, thank you so much. I think the point you made about our clients don't have the vocabulary. There's one of my favorite books in Made to Stick. They talk about, it's actually where they got the name Sticky Albums. It's a fantastic marketing book. They talk about the curse of knowledge, where mm-hmm. we are experts in photography. Like mm-hmm. that's what we know in and out, and we can talk about photography for hours and hours. Our clients don't have that vocabulary. They don't know exactly what they want yet, and they don't even know how to talk about it. And it's our job to guide them along this path. And where I think people run into frustration is they try to do it at the end. Because we get wrapped up in the emotion, the excitement of taking pictures, and then we go, okay, now I'm gonna try some of these new tricks I'm learning.
Mm-hmm.
It's too late. It's too late mm-hmm. to do a lot of stuff if you've already been hired, because expectations been set. so much of selling additional products and, mm-hmm. And delivering additional service is done on the front end before the shoot even occurs. So take that and please check out Jenica's blog, as well as her, we've got links to the ebook we've been talking about throughout the conversation. Jenica, thank you so much for your time today. I had a blast, and we're going to have to do another call down the road because there's so much we can talk about.
Yeah, thank you for having me. It's been a pleasure. I love talking about this stuff. I could do it forever. And anyone who's watching, feel free to stop by and say hi anytime.
Awesome. Bye-bye.